Okay, so let's start the seminar today. We are very happy to have Juan Ramón Muñoz de Nova. He's going to talk about entanglement and quantum tomography with top quarks at the LHC. So please.
Okay, thanks a lot for the invitation first. So today I'm going to speak about entanglement and quantum tomography with top quarks at the LHC. This paper has been published in the European Physical Journal Plus last year. And this work has been done in collaboration with UFAPIC from the physics department of CERN. So I will begin by giving a brief overview of the talk. First, I will begin by giving some motivation to study our problem. Then I will give some basics of quantum information, specifically about quantum tomography and entanglement. Then I will briefly review the high energy physics part of this project, which is based, first, we'll review the standard model. In particular, I will review the top quark physics. Then, once I have introduced the top quark, we will analyze the top antitop production in elementary QCD processes, in particular through leading order processes, which are quark antiquark production and also gluon fusion production. Finally, we'll study realistic processes with hadrons, both in the LHC and the tevatron, and I will discuss the experimental implementation of these ideas. And I will conclude the talk by giving some conclusions and outlook. So I will begin by the motivation. What's the motivation? Okay. So the standard model of particle physics is a relativistic quantum field theory. That means that it's made of special relativity and quantum mechanics. Therefore, we can test fundamental properties of quantum mechanics within the standard model. The interest of this is that by implementing some canonical techniques in quantum information, we can pave the way to study quantum information theory also at high energy colliders. So why is this interesting? This is interesting because it will represent the highest energy study of these properties at the frontier of the known physics. And there are a lot of advantages of doing this because the high energy colliders are generally relativistic. They have very exotic interactions and symmetries. They also have a very fundamental nature because the constituents and the laws behind their behavior are fundamental. So I hope that now that we are highly motivated, we can switch to quantum information part of this project. First, I will begin to discuss about what is a quantum state. Okay, we know from basic quantum mechanics that any quantum system is completely described by its wave function, which is a coherent mixture of quantum states. We can think, for instance, a coherent mixture of eigenstate of certain Hamiltonian. Now, the question is, can we measure a wave function? Well, the answer is yes, essentially. What does it mean? It means that we can measure the wave function, or in better speaking, we can measure each coefficient of this expansion. It's by measuring the expectation values of a set of observables, OK, from this equation, which is a quadratic equation in the amplitudes. However, this raises several problems. First, technically, we can only measure amplitudes and relative phases. Second, in order to measure an expectation value, we have to repeat the experiment many times. This is a problem because the quantum state can change from repetition to repetition of the experiment. And sometimes we cannot access the full quantum state, but we can only observe certain portion of information of this quantum state. So we cannot measure the complete wave function. So these problems are avoided by using a description of the quantum state in terms of a density matrix. This density matrix is a non-negative Hermitian operator with unit trace in certain Hilbert space. In particular, the case of a pure wave state, a wave function is accounted by this kind of expression for a density matrix. And the expectation values of observables evaluated in this quantum state are evaluated simply as this product trace of here. Indeed, any kind of quantum state, as it is an Hermitian operator with non-negative character, it represents an incoherent mixture of quantum states, this phi n, with some probability pn, which this is an statistical mixture of quantum states. Now, we have this quantum state. The question is now, can we measure this quantum state? The answer is yes. If we now measure a sufficient number of expectation values, we can in principle extract each coefficient of the density matrix, which we know now is a linear relation. And this is the basics of quantum tomography. Quantum tomography is the reconstruction of a quantum system from the measurement of the expectation values of a selected set of observables. Now, we are going to discuss about entanglement. Entanglement arises naturally in bipartite systems, which are formed by the direct product of two subsystems A and B. Entanglement is defined in this context as the non-separability of a bipartite quantum state. In particular, in the case of a wave function, separability is defined as a direct product of two wave functions in each of space. So in this case, we have that if the states are correlated, they are entangled. However, for a general quantum state described by a density matrix of this form, separability takes this form, which is a little more complicated. And it turns out that any classical correlated state, which is described by any classical probability distribution in the Hilbert space, can be described by this specific form, which is a separability as defined by Werner. Here, I would like to notice that correlation does not imply entanglement. Okay, we can have classically correlated states, but then they are not entangled, okay? So entanglement, in some sense, measures some kind of non-classical behavior of the system in the sense that it's not described by a classical theory of probability. It's not that it's just random, but it goes farther. It cannot even be described by classical probability theory. So I will review with some basic examples these concepts. For instance, the quantum tomography for one qubit is very simple. Qubit, as we know, is the most simple quantum system, which is a system with only two states. For example, a spin half, one half particle. The most general form of the density matrix for one qubit takes this form in terms of Pauli matrices. And as we can see, we only need three parameters to characterize the quantum state, to determine it. And these parameters can be determined by the measurement of the spin polarization B of the particle. So once we know the quantum state of the system, we can know the spin polarization in any direction from this vector B. Now, we can extrapolate these concepts to the case of two qubits. In this case, the most general form of the density matrix for two qubits, which is a Hilbert space of dimension 2 by 2, takes this form in terms of the Pauli matrices of the two particles. Now, we have 15 parameters to determine the quantum state of the system, which can be, again, obtained from a measurement of spin polarizations and spin correlations. In particular, these vector Bs are obtained from the spin polarizations of each particle, and the spin correlation matrix C, which goes here, is obtained by the spin correlations. So again, once we know the quantum state of the system, we can compute any kind of expectation value that we want. Now, with two qubits, we can also think about entanglement. One qubit cannot be entangled, but two qubits can be. So in our case, the most general form of any separable quantum state takes this form with P some probability. Okay, these vectors are unit vectors describing the spin polarizations, and this P is a classical probability distribution. So the spin correlations are purely classical for a separable quantum state. Now, how can we distinguish if a state is entangled? Well, perfectly know that the most used entanglement criterion in this case is the Peres-Hordecki criterion, which states that if rho is separable, the partial transpose of this quantum state must be non-negative if the state is separable. Therefore, if this partial transpose is not non-negative, the original state was entangled. And actually, in 2 by 2 systems, the Peres-Hordecki criterion is not only a sufficient, but also a necessary condition for entanglement. That is, the system is entangled if and only if it satisfies the Peres-Hordecki criterion. A more quantitative measurement of entanglement is provided by the concurrence, which is this function of here, this complicated function of here, which is the max between 0 and this sum of eigenvalues, where these eigenvalues are from this matrix of here, C of rho, and this is defined in terms of the complex conjugate of the density matrix. Apart from this complicated definition, the most basic thing that we need to know from the concurrence is that it's a function, a positive function, which oscillates between 0 and 1, and is larger than 0 if and only if the state is entangled. In particular, if it's equal to 1, the state is maximally entangled. In particular, the concurrence is related to the so-called entanglement of formations, this formula, where H is the typical Shannon entropy. Now, all these techniques that I have related are very well known in the lab. Specifically, the quantum tomography is nowadays a standard technique in the lab. It can be done with superconducting qubits, with photons, also with atoms. Okay, this is the typical plot that one has from the quantum tomography, representing all the coefficients of the density matrix, including the real and the imaginary part. Also, entanglement has been tested in a lot of systems. Okay, we can see here like macroscopic objects, superconducting qubits, macroscopic diamonds, analog Hawking radiation, atoms, solid state qubits with nitrogen vacancy centers. So I would like just to say that testing entanglement in any new system is highly interesting by itself, because entanglement is perhaps the most genuine feature of quantum mechanics. So it has a lot of fundamental interest just to measure it in any new system. Now I will switch to the part of high energy physics. So I will begin by reviewing the standard model of particle physics, which, as I have explained, is a relativistic quantum field theory. In particular, it's made of this table, which is like the periodic table of particle physics, okay? So first we have fermions, the fundamental fermions, one half fermions, which come in three generations and are described right here, are divided between quarks and leptons. I will explain later what's the difference. These are the fundamental particles. Now, these particles interact through interacting gauge bosons, which are rated here. And these interactions are described by a Young-Mills theory of this type, SU3 by SU2 by U1. And the remaining particle of the standard model, or at least the known part of the standard model, is the Higgs boson, which was only discovered in the last decade. So I will begin by explaining the interactions. Interactions are, as explained, mediated by spin-1 gauge bosons. In particular, the electromagnetic interactions are mediated by photons, as we know. Weak interactions are mediated by the C0 WB bosons, which are massive. And strong interactions are mediated by gluons. Electromagnetic and weak interactions are unified through the electroweak theory, which we can see here, at the energy scale that it enters, while strong interactions are studied within the framework of quantum chromodynamics, which is described by SU3 theory, as compared to the electroweak theory, which is SU2 by U1 theory. U1 is the photon, the U2 comes from the weak interactions. Now we come to the fermions of the standard model. So to explain it, these particles are spin 1/2 fermions. I would like also to mention that each of these particles has its own empty particle with opposite charge and the same mass. And in particular, we can distinguish according to the QCD character between quarks and leptons. Quarks do interact through strong interactions through QCD, while leptons do not interact through QCD. In particular, between leptons, we can distinguish between neutrinos and these charged leptons, which are, for instance, the electron and the moon and the tau. Now, these particles are many times produced in particle antiparticle pairs through interacting processes. Therefore, this kind of particle antiparticle production is a natural candidate for a two-qubit entangled system to study this kind of quantum information problems. In particular, we will focus in this talk on the top quark. So what's the top quark? Who is the top quark? Okay. The top quark is the most massive fundamental particle known to exist. It was only discovered in 95, which is like 25 years ago, by the D0 and CDF collaborations at the Tevatron, at the Fermilab, Illinois. Top quarks are produced in top antitop pairs through QCD processes or electroweak processes. As I explained, they are natural candidates to study entanglement. So why top quarks? What's the interesting thing about them? Well, the issue is that they have such a large mass, they are the most massive particles on the system, they also have a very large width, which is of the order of the 1 GeV. This implies that the top quarks have an extremely short lifetime of this 10 to the minus 25 seconds. This implies that the top quarks decay well before any other process can affect their spins, like hadronization or spin decorrelation. This implies that the spin information of the top quarks is transferred directly to the leptonic decay products, with no decoherence or randomization of these spin correlations. They are perfectly transferred to the decay products. In particular, due to the rotational invariance in the rest frames of the top and the antitop, the lepton and antilepton that result from their decay are aligned along their spins of this top antitop pair. So that means that the TT bar spins can be measured from the direction of these leptonic decay products. And in particular, this technique is well established because it has been already measured by the D0 and CDF collaborations at the Tevatron, but also by the ATLAS and the CMS collaboration at the LHC. Now, what's the physics of the top TT bar pair, the top antitop pair? Well, in the center of mass frame, they are described by essentially two main quantities. One is the invariant mass, which is defined in terms of understand variables through this. And the other one is the top direction in the center of mass frame. Okay, they are produced in the center of mass frame with opposite directions, as we can see here, both the top and the antitop. And the, this is the angle that with respect to the original beam that produced the TT bar pair. And we can relate the velocity in this frame, the top velocity beta, with the invariant mass MTT bar, which is go like this. So this means that at zero velocity of the top, I mean, the threshold production, the invariant mass of the top pair is twice the top pair mass, which is logical because this is the energy on the center of mass frame. So the minimum energy to produce a top antitop pair is twice the mass of the top, which is the threshold production, and it's approximately equal to 1346 gigaelectrons. Now, how do we translate high energy physics features into quantum information language? This is done in terms of the so-called spin production density matrix, which, as we can see, takes a very similar form to the spin density matrix of two qubits. In particular, this description of the quantum state of the TT bar in terms of a density matrix is quite natural because we have to average over many bands and we cannot control typically the initial state. We cannot control the spins of the initial state, the color degrees of freedom. So this in high energy colliders, the description by a density matrix is a genuine feature of high energy physics. Particularly, we can obtain this proper density matrix describing the spins of the TT bar pair by normalizing this production spin density matrix of the, by this form. So it has trace one. And in particular, expectation values for a given production process with fixed MTT bar, with invariant mass, fixed invariant mass and top direction are computed by usual trace product of the operator. Now that we have the basics, we can switch to the real business of our talk, which is TT bar production in elementary QCD processes. I will begin with a very illustrative example, which is QCD production of TT bar pairs through an analytical leading order calculation. Why is this very interesting and so illustrative? It is because, first of all, we can obtain analytical results. Second, next to leading order are very small. And the third reason is that these leading order processes are like the building blocks of actual high energy processes, which are given in terms of algorithms, as we will see later. So at leading order QCD, we only have two main processes to create a TT bar pair. One is quark anti-quark fusion with like quarks, like up, down. And the second one is gluon fusion, glue plus glue, which here we have some kind of representative Feynman diagrams for these processes. And the idea is that each of these initial states give rise to a different quantum state. So I would like to speak now to the quantum information community, because I would like to mention that this is very simple. We don't have to fear, because we have all this magnitude, this density matrix is a QCD input. It's computed by high energy physicists. But once they do it, what we have is a simple, extremely simple quantum information problem. It's a textbook problem of a two-qubit quantum state. So we can study all the quantum information properties that we want. In particular, since it is a quantum state of two qubits, it has a similar decomposition as we have explained in terms of the spin polarizations of each particle and the spin correlations. And for computing these spin polarizations and spin correlations, we need to choose a fixed orthonormal basis to compute the quantum state. Particular, we will choose the so-called elicity basis. In the elicity basis, takes these three vectors, K, R, N, where K goes along the direction of the top quark pair, This is P, which is the original beam. For instance, this is the direction of the glue-glue or the quark anti-quark in the center of mass frame. Okay, it's this axis. P, this angle is the production angle, cos theta, and we define R as the perpendicular vector to the top direction in the beam top plane. And finally, this N vector is perpendicular to this plane. Okay, goes towards us. Why is this orthonormal frame so interesting? Because in the center of mass frame, this frame is equivalent to the top parent frames and the anti-top parent frames, where spins are well defined. They're equivalent through a Lorentz transformation, a Lorentz boost. Since this Lorentz boost is along this direction, the K direction, which is the top direction, they do not change the orientation of this orthonormal basis. So even if we go to each of these parent frames, the orientation of this of the relativity basis doesn't change. So it's fixed, it's not altered by doing this Lorentz boost to the top anti-top parent frames. That is why it's so interesting. In particular, we are going to study the form of the quantum state at leading order QCD. Leading order QCD in the standard model implies several things. First, the TT bar quantum state is unpolarized. There is no net polarization. Second, the correlation matrix is symmetric. This implies also, there is another consequence, is that of the standard model, that the spin along the perpendicular plane, along the n direction, is uncorrelated to the other directions. What this implies that the correlation matrix is simply described of this form, and is described only in terms of four parameters, which are the diagonal elements plus this non-diagonal element. Only four elements of these 15 elements are needed at leading order. I would like to mention that, moreover, due to the invariance along the axis, around the beam axis, all magnitudes only depend on the top velocity beta and the production angle theta. So it's a two-dimensional phase space. In particular, for the detection of entanglement, the Peres-Hodgkin criterion is equivalent to delta larger than zero, where delta is defined as this sum of these diagonal elements. It doesn't involve non-diagonal elements. And the concurrence is also an equivalent condition to entanglement, as I explained before. It's just the max between this delta and zero over two. So that means that they are consistent, these two conditions, the Peres-Hodgkin and the concurrence. Particularly, we will use the concurrence because it's a quantitative measurement of the degree of entanglement. Now, we are going to study QQ bar production, quark anti-quark production. So the initial state is a couple of quark anti-quark, in particular light quark anti-quark, like up-down quarks, that give rise to some TT bar quantum state, which is rho QQ bar. It depends on beta and theta. And what we can do is to plot the concurrence of this quantum state as a function of beta and theta. In particular, what we do when we try to analyze entanglement is to plot delta, is delta magnitude of the previous slide. And what we obtain is that it's always larger than zero, which means that the TT bar pair is entangled in all phase space. The only region in which is not entangled is whenever beta is equal to zero, or the production angle is zero. But in the rest of the phase space, in the bulk, is the TT bar pair is always entangled for quark anti-quark production. Now, we can understand the nature of this plot from two limits. As I explained, the first limit is either threshold, this beta equals zero production, or aligned production, like a production with angle close to the beam. In that case, the correlation matrix is of this form. And what means is what we have is that we have perfectly correlated spins along the beam axis. And this is a classically correlated separable state. This explains why the concurrence is so small in these limits. Because in this limit, the state is separable. It's a classically correlated state. This form is 50% of having both top, anti-top with the spin ups, or 50% of having both spins down along the direction of the beam. Now, the second limit is the high PT, the high transverse momentum, the ultra relativistic limit, which is this upper corner of the plot. In this limit, orbital angular momentum dominates the process, and the system is described, the T bar pair is described by a spin triplet state along the perpendicular n axis. It takes this form, is this quantum state of we see here, this spin triplet. And this is a maximally entangled state. That is why the concurrence is so high in this upper corner of the plot. Now we switch to gluon-gluon fusion. In this case, what we have is a pair of gluons that collide and produce the TT bar quantum state rho GG. And what we have is this delta function. It takes this more complicated form for gluon fusion. And there are now the TT bar pair is only entangled in two limits. One is from threshold here in this region. Then there is a band of separability. Here, the quantum state of the TT bar pair is separable. This black line separated into two regions. And again, at the high PT ultra relativistic limit, we have again entanglement. So how do we understand this plot? Again, close to threshold, what we have is that the TT bar pair is producing a spin singlet state, which we note it was the original example by Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosenow. Entangled state is maximally entangled in the spin singlet. It's also invariant under rotation, which will be very important, we will discuss later. This is the first limit, close to threshold. It's strong entanglement region. There is some transient, which there is a separability, and then we reach again the second limit, which is high PT. And here in this limit, we have exactly the same triplet state as in QQ bar production. Because why? Because in this limit, as we have explained, orbital angular momentum dominates. So in this case, there is the system doesn't know about the individual constituents of the initial state. Either QQ bar or glu glu gives the same quantum state, this triplet state of here. Now we will switch to the TT bar production in realistic QCD processes. Sadly, I will have to say that we don't have in nature free quarks and gluons. They are never isolated. This is because of color confinement. Once we try to separate both, they generate again other particles because of this confinement, and they cannot be isolated, never. In particular, we find all these quarks and gluons forming the hadrons. Hadrons are protons, neutrons, mesons, all these kind of particles. These particles, as we see here, for instance, this is the proton, are a soup of quarks and gluons. Okay, if we examine it in detail what's inside a proton, we find, apart from these two up and down quarks, we find a soup of quarks and gluons. These individual parts that form any hadron are called initially partons. This parton model was first developed by Feynman at the end of the 60s. And the composition of any hadron is described by the so-called parton distribution function, PDF, which has not to be confused with the usual PDF file. I have to admit that usually I had many problems at the beginning of my work in high-energy physics with this term. Okay, sometimes it happened. Now, how this kind of modification affects our previous calculations. So what we have in realistic processes is that instead of having quarks and gluons, what we have is the collision of some hadrons. For instance, at the late C, we have proton-proton collisions that after some intermediate things, they give, in terms of this leading order elementary processes that I described before, they give rise to a TT bar pair. At the tevatron, the situation is similar, but now we have proton-antiproton collisions. So now, how is the quantum state depends on the initial states? Okay. Now, the idea is that we have a quantum state rho that depends also on the center of mass energy of the proton-proton or the proton-antiproton beam. This is square root of S. Now, what's this expression? Well, this expression just tells us, okay, you have these elementary states, these elementary partonic states, which come from these elementary building blocks. Okay, as I explained before, they are given in terms of quark, anti-quark, and gluon-gluon fusion. These are the elementary quantum states that I described before. And the total quantum state is just this, a sum of these quantum states with some probability. This probability is computed, this weight is computed in terms of these partial distribution functors that I explained before. So In general, a total QCD process is just the sum of these elementary processes that I explained before with some weight, some probability, which is given in terms of the pattern distribution function. Again, for the quantum information people, we don't have to be worried because this is very simple. What we have is from QCD, we have these quantum states as before, and these probabilities, which are computed in terms of complicated pastor distribution functions, in terms of computed PDFs. But this is not our problem, okay? It's a problem with the higher efficiencies. Once they compute these things, we can solve quantum information problems. And this quantum information problem is extremely simple and it comes in the textbooks. It's just a problem of a convex sum of two-qubit quantum states. Now, I will, with these basics, we can finally switch to real experimental process. Now, in any realistic measurement, one averages over many events and many processes to increase the sigma. One does not measure a single energy and single angle because that has not enough statistics to distinguish the sigma. So for that purpose, we define a total quantum state in some region pi of the phase space MTT bar and top direction, which is defined by this integral. This integral has these quantum states coming from this hadronic production for fixed energy and top direction, and we sum over them with some probability. This total quantum state definition is very intuitive. What we have is just the sum of these quantum states in this region pi with some probability, and this probability turns out to be just proportional to the corresponding differential cross section. It's essentially the normalized differential cross section in this region pi. So again, what we have is a problem in quantum information where the input comes again from QCD. In QCD, you compute again these quantum states, as I explained in the previous slides, these probabilities that come from the cross section. And with both things, what we have is a quantum information problem, which is again the convex sum of two-qubit quantum states. So it's extremely simple. Once they give us this probability and these quantum states, we can do everything. Particular, we can ask about the quantum tomography of this total quantum state. How can we measure this quantum state? Well, we know from the quantum tomography that as a two-qubit quantum state, we'll need to measure the spin polarizations and the spin correlations. Okay, and this is the best part of the business, that actually, in high energy physics, they can actually measure the spin polarization and the spin correlation matrix by measuring the cross section of a d-leptonic decay. Each of the tops, we have some production process that produce some top and some antitop. Each particle, an antiparticle, decays in a bottom quark, some double B plus, and the antiparticle, the antitop, decays in anti-bottom, and double B minus. And these W bosons, they decay also, and they decay in terms of a neutrino and a lepton, and the same from the W minus. So by following the directions of these leptons here, we only focus on these leptons, and characterizing their cross-section, we can measure each coefficient, this B plus, B minus, and the correlation matrix of the quantum state, where this directions are the lepton directions in each of the top or anti-top rest frames. Okay, we go to the rest frame in which this decays, and we look for the direction of this. And as we can see, we can by these coefficients depend on the reconstruction that we do. We can select any region pi of the phase space. We can reconstruct for certain directions of the top of quark state and invariant mass. Okay, so we can select this at will, this kind of region of phase space where we want to define the total quantum state. Now, we analyze the individual production process at the TT bar from PP collisions at the lead C at the center of mass energy of 13 tera-electron volts. This actually was the center of mass energy of round two of the lead C. So the data is already recorded there. Again, as I explained it, we have proton-proton collisions, PP collisions, and the quantum state, at the leading order, is going to be a statistical mixture of the quantum states for each individual production process, either for an initial quark-antiquark process or some gluon-gluon process. Here we plot, now in terms of MTT bar, all the concurrences. This is the concurrence from gluon-gluon. Again, we see these two regions, one close to threshold and one at high PT, where the state is entangled. From quark-quark, we see this plot again, where we see there is almost no entanglement close to threshold or aligned production, but for high PT, we have again this ultra-relativistic limit of maximally entangled state in a triplet state. Now we switch to the real case of this density matrix, which is a combination of both. And as we can see from this form, it's very similar to the case of pure gluon production. Why is this? Well, because at the late C, gluon-gluon fusion dominates the TT bar production. That is why we can mostly understand the TT bar production at the HC in terms of the gluon process. Moreover, we can compare these plots with the actual cross section of the process to understand in which limits we are going to have larger signal, and which will imply a larger amount of statistics because we need to have a statistical significant detection of entanglement. And here we see that only close to threshold, we have a strong cross section, which suggests that we should restrict to a small MTT bar section close to threshold to examine entanglement. So, in light of these results, we take our quantum state by averaging over all directions of the top quark and integrating between threshold, which I remember that the minimum invariant mass of the top pair is the minimum mass, minimum energy of the top pair, which is twice the top of the mass. And we integrate from threshold to some given mass, entity bar. Now, in order to characterize this quantum state, I would like to notice that the LCT basis, it means changes direction with each event, is useless to characterize this quantum state. So for characterizing this quantum state, we need to use a fixed basis with some fixed directions in space. And in particular, we choose the beam basis, in which the C axis is along the beam and the XY axis are transverse directions to the beam. Okay, this is the PP direction. So we take the beam, the C directions along the axis of the PP, and the transverse directions are the X and the Y. It doesn't matter really how we change it, how we choose them, because due to the symmetry around the beam axis, the correlation matrix is diagonal. So it doesn't matter. And this is very natural because we have a beam. So there is, if this is the collision, there is imbalance in the rotations along this axis. So it doesn't matter where we choose the X and Y. Indeed, this is reflected in the correlation matrix, which is diagonal, and in particular, this Cx is equal to Cy and is called the perpendicular spin correlations. And as I explained, because it's a fixed basis in direction space, it's a good choice to characterize this quantum state, which for this computation, we have to average over all possible top directions. So this, as I recall, this LCT basis is useless to characterize the total quantum state. Now, we use this total quantum state, rho MTT bar, and we ask for its entanglement. Now, at leading order, it turns out that due to gluon-gluon dominance, the Peres-Holecki criterion is equivalent to D, which is defined at the trace of the correlation matrix over 3, to be smaller than minus 1/3. We represent here D, this is the cyan line. Okay, as we can see, below some threshold, below some critical value of about 560 GeV, the state is actually entangled because this is the limit of minus 1/3. So in this region, this total quantum state is entangled. And actually we can compute it from quantum tomography, this kind of the correlation matrix. And because of the properties of the gluon product, gluon fusion, if you remember, gluon fusion close to threshold produces a TT bar pair in a spin singlet state, we can compute this from the trace of the correction matrix. By the trace of the correction matrix is invariant under rotation. So we can actually compute the trace of the correction matrix in any orthonormal basis. We don't need to choose for this purpose this beam basis. We can do it in any orthonormal basis, actually. Even in the LCD basis, we can compute this trace. Actually, and this is even more interesting, we can measure the trace of the correlation matrix, the trace of the correlation matrix directly from the cross section of the dileptonic decay. In particular, we can measure this cross section where this phi is the angle between the lepton directions in the parent rest frames. So we can measure directly an entanglement marker with one single measurement, one single parameter. We measure D, and we can know if the system is entangled or not. If D is smaller than minus 1/3, the system is entangled with just one measurement. We don't need here to do more correlations or to measure the complete quantum state from quantum tomography. Only one parameter, which is directly measurable in experiments, gives us an entanglement marker. This is very, very interesting, and it's very uncommon to do it for entanglement experiments. And here we present in this plot a perspective for the measuring of entanglement, where here we plot the relative uncertainty of D, and here we represent the MTT bar. As we explain close to 560, that is above this value, this critical value, there is no entanglement. But below here, if we have relative uncertainties up to 10% or something less, depending on the cut that we impose, something be almost 10% or a little less, we can actually have a 5 sigma, this is the number of statistical uncertainties, we can have an actual 5 sigma detection. Okay, so this is very interesting. Actually, we can see here, this is more or less like 4 sigma, this is like 3 sigma. So we can have high statistical significance for the measurement of entanglement, at least according to some estimations. If we have relative uncertainties up to some values, which are actually typical values of the measurement of D, okay? Everything has to be, there is some kind of trade-off between the cut and the relative uncertainty, but this suggests that, yes, we can do it at least with some, we are confident to do it with high statistical significance. Now, so far we have addressed the problem of entanglement at leading order. At leading order, due to this gluon-gluon dominance, D is smaller than minus 1/3 is a necessary and sufficient condition for the presence of entanglement. Now, in general, in the general process, not a leading order, one can always characterize entanglement from quantum tomography. Once done with quantum tomography, the quantum state, we can compute it with the entanglement with concurrence, we can detect it with Perez-Horodecki, there are a lot of theoretical criteria. But, and very interestingly, I would like to note that still D smaller than minus 1/3 is always a sufficient condition for entanglement. Why? Because for a separable state, the trace of the correlation matrix, which is the product of the two spin polarizations, can be, in classical terms, compute through this integral, which, after some Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, gives this. Now, the trace of the correlation matrix has to be always smaller than one in absolute value. Therefore, if D in absolute value is larger than 1/3, what we have is the violation of a Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, which is well known in quantum optics and other systems to provide an unambiguous signature of genuine quantum behavior. In particular, in this case, this means that our system cannot be described by any classical probability theory. So what we have is a genuine quantum system, this is precisely entanglement, the genuine quantum characteristic, genuine quantum feature. Finally, I would like to go to discuss the implementation of quantum tomography. Now, at leading order, this is very boring. Because why? Okay. The TT bar pair is unpolarized, so we only need the spin correlations. But as I explained, due to this symmetry around the bin axis and the rotations, the correlation matrix is diagonal. So we only need two parameters, which are this perpendicular correlation and this longitudinal spin correlations. So in order, we only need two parameters. However, in real processes include higher order corrections, but here comes the most interesting thing. Since the process is invariant and the rotations are on the bin axis, now we only need, in general, four parameters. which are these perpendicular spin correlations and the longitudinal spin correlations, and also the longitudinal spin correlations of the top and the antitop along the bin axis. Now, I would like to notice that even two next to the other corrections, these coefficients are going to be very small. So in general, we will only, with these two coefficients, we will have enough information about the quantum state of the system. Of course, if we don't want to make any assumption on the front of the quantum state, although this kind of rotational invariance on the bin axis is something very logical and very well established, we can always do the full quantum tomography and actually check explicitly this invariance and the rotations by measuring the 15 parameters in some fixed spatial basis, like the mean basis. And so we have to measure these 15 parameters, which are these 9 spin correlations and these 6 individual spin polarizations, these 3 components for the top and the other 3 components of the spin polarization of the antitop. Finally, I would like to summarize the main results of this study. First, we like to notice that the entanglement between a TTPR pair can be observed at late C with high statistical significance using the current data recorded during the round 2 of the late C. If this detection is achieved, it will be the first detection ever of entanglement in quarks, at least in fundamental quarks, not in mesons or baryons. And also, as a bonus, we will have the highest energy entanglement observation in history, because this is at the highest energy scale, tens of orders of magnitude larger than typical experiments. So that is why it's so interesting. Also, we will, by doing the quantum tomography of the TTBAR quantum state, we will achieve the first implementation of this technique in a high energy collider. I would like to notice that the measurement of a quantum state is something very fundamental in quantum mechanics, and it's a key tool in quantum information theory. So I would also like to say that quantum tomography goes even beyond the detection of entanglement, because we have full access to the complete quantum state of the system, to all the information of the quantum state. And just for the final slide, I will summarize the conclusions and the possible perspective and outlooks of this work. First, I would like to notice that by implementing these studies, this quantum information, this quantum entanglement detection, this quantum tomography, what we are doing is implementing the ABC of quantum information at the late C. So these techniques pave the way to study quantum information theory and some quantum information problems in high energy physics. And because of this, this project has a strong interdisciplinary nature, huge potential, is also of great interest. Why? Because from the quantum information perspective, high energy colliders provide new systems to study fundamental problems in quantum information, also fundamental, in general, fundamental aspects of quantum mechanics at the highest energy scale ever. Because of this, high energy colliders are very interesting because they have a genuine relativistic nature. They exhibit a very interesting symmetries, like this Young-Mills theory that I explained to you. So these interactions, like QCD interactions, which have color degrees of freedom, are very interesting because of this exotic character. And also, I would like to notice the fundamental character of the constituents of these high-energy colliders. They're described by fundamental laws, not the effective models. And actually, for instance, we have seen the top antitop pair, when it's the case, is not even affected by the coherence, for instance. Possible extensions of this work are a lot. It's very interesting because, for instance, we can extend this study to the tevatron, to the future circular collider. I have seen that you have a talk on the future circular collider next week, so you can discuss about this, perhaps. In particular, in the future circular collider, you are going to have E plus E minus collider. And this case is extremely interesting for quantum information because, in this case, the spins of the initial state can be controlled, which is very interesting. We can also try to study quantum information with Kutrich, which are given by massive spin one gauge bosons like WB plus minus. Also, we can try to study quantum discord in the region in which the TTBAR pair is not entangled. It's a very interesting problem. We can do it through quantum tomography. And the other interest of this work is from a high energy perspective. Why is interesting for high energy physicists this project? Because Well, quantum information is a very rich field, which is, has a lot of results and a lot of people working in it. So it has a lot of tools and techniques, and many of these techniques can open new lines of research and inspire new approaches to the field of high energy physics. In particular, one of the most straightforward applications is the use of quantum tomography. Quantum tomography provides a new experimental platform to test new physics beyond the standard model. We can compute, for instance, the prediction of the standard model for certain quantum state of the TT-bar pair, and then compare with the actual measurement through quantum tomography. If our prediction doesn't coincide, it means that there is some kind of new physics there that is operating, and we can actually compare with new physics beyond the standard model models to study these kind of discrepancies. So I would like to thank you all for the talk. This is all. Thanks a lot for attending.
Thank you very much, Juan Ramón, for this very nice talk, this very interesting talk. So there are some questions.
May I ask something?
Sure.
Yeah, so Gustav, I mean, we were discussing that this, in general, this state will be mixed states, right? So then you will know what, how pure are the states, I mean, for prediction. Do you expect to be very pure these states or not?
No, well, no, because first of all, they cease to be pure, even if at threshold, gluon-gluon production is pure, once you begin to integrate, you lose this purity.
Okay.
So there are actually two reasons for this loss. The first one is this one. The quantum state for fixed energy and direction is a statistical mixture of the initial states.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So this is the weight. So just because of this nature, they are not pure states. Also, they cannot, in turn, these quantum states cannot be pure.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, for instance, close to threshold, as I explained, for quark anti-quark processes, this is not a pure state. Mm-hmm. So let's say that there are three levels, actually. The first one is at the level of the quantum state. At the level of the quantum state, they cannot be. They are never real pure states, only in some limits. Okay. Mm-hmm. The second one is the statistical mixture between processes. Mm-hmm. And the third one is that in any actual process, we have to integrate. So it's by layer by layer, we are losing this purity.
Mm-hmm.
Still, we expect to survive some kind of entanglement due to this spin singlet state, which has to still be there somehow. So
mm-hmm. 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 You will be able to check analog of Bell inequalities here, or?
Well, that's a very delicate issue. Okay, first, close to threshold, no. At high energy, yes. Some recent papers have proposed it. But the point is that because of this, it seems that you are not going to have enough statistics. There are some recent paper that has said that has analyzed in detail this proposal and has said that you will have it with one sigma, which is very low, statistically mm-hmm. significant. Also, I would like to mention that this is only for the statistical significance. Now, Bell test inequalities are not like entanglement measurements. Okay, it's not just to measure some spin correlations, because in the measurement process, you need to discard local realism. You need to discard like hidden variable models.
Mm-hmm.
So in order to do that, you need to do very, very specific measurement settings. So you have to ensure that all the measurements are causally disconnected.
Mm-hmm.
You have to ensure that, you have to repeat the experiment. You have to ensure that the measurement of each process mm-hmm. is causally disconnected from the next production.
Uh-huh.
Of the entangled pair, so you also have to do some kind of to break the free will loophole. Okay, you have to choose. You can choose the directions. In the LHC, you cannot do it because they come from the direction of the leptons, and those are chosen by the model. So if you have a hidden variable model, You can argue that these directions are chosen by the hidden variables, but you don't choose the direction of the leptons. Mm-hmm. You only recall these directions, but you don't choose the spin axis. Mm-hmm. So if you ask me, I will say that not only because of the statistical significance, but also because of the extremely difficult nature to test a loophole-free Bell test, mm-hmm. I don't think they are very useful. You can do some preliminary test, of course, mm-hmm. but to do a real loophole-free test, mm-hmm. I don't think you will ever, at least with the current colliders, perhaps in the future the design, but this is very natural. If you think so, Bell HC was not built to test Bell inequalities. Mm-hmm. So it's very natural that this setting is not optimized to test Bell inequalities.
Okay, yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
Actually, I would like just to mention that I think the first loophole-free violations were only measured in the last decade. So it's been many, 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 many years because it's very difficult. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So some more questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank Juan Ramón. And okay, so we close the seminar.
Thanks a lot for the invitation and for the opportunity.
Mm-hmm. Thank you to you.
Bye bye, thanks.
Thank you. Bye.